Thank you. Was it really?
When you sit down,
we ready to start?
Good morning. It's great to see everybody here. It's wonderful to see familiar faces. Lots of them I've either seen in the classroom or I'm seeing now in the classroom. My name is Andrea Houston. I'm a member of the finance faculty here at Miami Herbert, and I'm also the academic director of our real estate program. And those of you that know me know I think real estate is a fantastic asset. So it's a great pleasure that I have today to be part of the host of our very exclusive Future of Real Estate program. And I'm joined here by the head of the Miami McKinsey office, because we do this in collaboration with them. And it's really nice that we are going to feature real estate today. So let me introduce Andre Cuba, managing partner, and he'll say a few words.
Thank you. Good morning, I'm Andre Dewar. I have the great privilege of being at McKinsey in Miami and leading what I was telling these folks at breakfast is one of our fastest growing offices in the world. And the reason that we are doing this series is, I think you know there are some other speaker series here at the business school which bring leaders from all over the world and all over the country. But what really struck us is there's a really distinctive set of leaders here in Florida and Miami. And we wanted to highlight that and use it as an opportunity to understand that style of leadership, how they run their companies, and to learn from them. So I think today we've got one of those leaders. To my left is Edgardo DeFortuna, who's the president and CEO and founder of the Fortune International Group. For those of you who know real estate, you'll know that it's a Miami-based full-service real estate firm which does sales and marketing and development, 80 to 90% in condominium residential. And I think, you know, Mr. Fortuna founded this in 1983 with a single office in Brickell that started as kind of the sales and property management of the first development, which was Jade Brickell. Mm-hmm. And since then, there's been remarkable growth. There's been the accumulation of lots of different properties and assets, particularly mainly in Florida. But today, the company basically has a collection of sales, leasing, new development, marketing, property management, and private lending services. So I think it's a real privilege today for us to have Mr. Fortuna. I know that he has a long-standing relationship with the University of Miami, and there may be some of the next generation of the family sitting somewhere in the room, not to point you out. So with that, I'd like us all to welcome Mr. Fortuna here today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
As Andre mentioned, you have been here since the early 1980s, which is actually when I started here. It was a very tumultuous time in financial markets back then. And since then, you have put your stamp and helped shape Miami. Can you give us a little bit of your background, how you came to be here and in the real estate business?
If you think there was tumultuous here, I'm originally from Argentina. really was tumultuous there. So like many things, things happen almost by accident. I was very happy and just finishing an engineering degree in Argentina, and my sister wanted to come to Miami, and my dad would not let her come by herself. So because she was just graduated as a doctor, so she convinced me to come to the University of Miami for 3 months, and at the English as a second language course, and a very intensive course in Miami, in the University of Miami here. And I said, okay, but only for 3 months, and then I'm back. Just purchased my car. I was really a cool guy, just graduated. And I always say that I came for 3 months, and they're still waiting for me to come back. Because I loved it so much that I decided that this was going to be the place to be. And in a way, really, real estate was kind of second nature. But when I decided to stay, I enrolled at the University of Miami and an MBA. And while I was doing the MBA, I realized that the people were not focusing on Latin America as a potential customer for real estate, especially brokers. So I said, really, there is a niche there to service the Latin American consumer that was just exploring Miami as a diversification for investment. And I started really paying attention to their needs and managing their units and trying to satisfy what they were looking for. And obviously, from managing, they turn into let's buy something, let's invest in something. So I created a structure around servicing the foreign investor here in Miami. And rather than waiting for them to come, we team up with financial people and lawyers and went in the different major cities in Latin America and educating people on how easy it was to invest in real estate in Miami by helping them structure their LLCs or legally and helping finance their acquisitions. So really created a company that specialized originally in satisfying and servicing the Latin American market. And of course, it was a great influx, and it being at the right time, in the right moment, it was very, very important for us.
Well, I want to maybe we can build on that, talk a little bit about the evolution of Miami. So I think everyone knows Miami's accomplishments recently are pretty dazzling. More than $2 trillion in assets under management have moved to Miami in the last couple of years. There's a burgeoning tech ecosystem. Miami's become maybe the number two fastest growing market for VC. It's the number one among all US cities for new business formation, actually. And as everyone probably knows, there are a few people moving to Miami recently. I like to say I'm the last of the early adopters. I came here before COVID, so I'm not one of these New Yorkers who are decided to leave just because of COVID. Perhaps the only thing we don't have as a city yet is Lionel Messi.
We're working on that.
So, you've been here now for a few decades. It'd be great to hear your reflections on the rise of Miami. And just what do you think have been some of the pivotal moments in the city over the last couple of decades?
There are really many, but like I was saying, it's been in the right place at the right time. Of course, the natural factors are continue to be very important. The climate, the location, the ability to travel pretty much anywhere in the world has made Miami really important as a location center for, especially for originally for companies that were doing business with the U.S. but based in Latin America or other places. But there are stages of transformation of Miami as a city, both in cultural activities and education. I think that if I have to pick one or two, I mean, the coming of Art Basel to Miami kind of happened gradually. It changed the perception of Miami as just a city for vacation and be just a more cultural city that really embrace that type of lifestyle. And of course, recently, the wave of people is two major factors. Of course, the tax law change Trump instituted in 2017-18, and of course, COVID was a major catalyst for people to discover that living and working in Miami was the perfect place to be. So, but all through that, of course, we lived through the cocaine cowboys and the crisis of immigration from Cuba that we have to absorb during the Mariel times. And we, of course, had the 2007-2009 crisis in the financial markets and the real estate markets. So certainly Miami has many, many cycles, but there are also many big up points that were very important to the growth of Miami.
Maybe just a quick follow-up question. Do you think, Miami has for a long time gone through this very robust, when things were great, it was really great. When things were bad, it was much worse than the rest of the country. Do you feel like now with the diversification of the economy, the arrival of private equity, venture capital, and other sorts of things, do you think Miami has now escaped in a way, or do you think that's still a risk?
Absolutely. I think that obviously there's always going to be cycles, and potentially we're to some extent going through one now, but a great change is the ability to have great jobs here, and those companies that you were mentioning, and the moving of major organizations up to Miami creates a different platform that it's significantly more stable. Before, at least from the real estate point of view, the boost and bust came because of different factors that happened in some countries in Latin America. When Latin America was really in trouble or had issues politically or socially, people were coming and migrating here. Then if there was something with a change with the rate of exchange that they couldn't afford anymore, they left and created speculations and up and downs, at least in the real estate world, but in pretty much translated into entire population in Miami. But now I think it's a lot more stable, even though, of course, we live 2 years of a great, almost unusual boom in the sense that everybody wanted to be in Miami, everybody wanted to work in Miami. Now today is a more stable market, but a very robust market that is still very attractive to many people.
Yeah, I thought there was a fascinating article in the Wall Street Journal this week. I don't know if you want that. Goldman Sachs basically predicted which markets are going to have a real estate bust. Miami was not on the list. It was Phoenix. It was Austin. And if you think about saying that there's going to be some real estate bust and it's not Miami, it's kind of shocking, actually.
We were always the poster child for in the world. And it's because it was an investment area, but also a speculation area. I mean, and unfortunately for Miami and real estate, when it did well, everybody wanted to be here. And typically when the perception becomes, it's overpriced or it's going fast soon, people react in the opposite way and created a big wave downturn. So you really have to be very careful, strategic, monitor those type of shifts. But before, it was a lot more critical than now. But I think that in today's world, at least in our city, or South Florida in general, Florida for that matter, is really a lot more stable.
It is. And one thing I learned at a conference a couple of weeks ago is a whole new acronym. I think everybody by now knows that WFH is work from home. But what's WFM? Work from Miami. And we are very lucky to benefit from that. Let's go back a little bit to just the business aspect of Fortune International. And the first thing I have to ask you is how lucky it is that your last name and the name of the company go together so well. It is a developer of luxury condos and also brokerage, but there are other sectors of your business. Have you talked a little bit about that also, help your clients?
Of course. I mean, again, we grew to try to satisfy the investors, especially the foreign investors. So we needed to really create the different teams in our organization that could satisfy that need. The development aspect today is the most important part of our organization. It comes as a flow from the information that we have as a sales company. I mean, we really fight with developers that do what they think is right rather than what the market is telling them that is right. I mean, having an organization with more than 850 general brokers that really provide all the information on a daily basis of what the customer wants and needs is what really we focus in to be able to do the projects and to develop the projects that we're doing. And so our company has basically four parts. The development company that mainly, as Andrew was saying, does 80 to 90% condominium residential for sale. The brokerage organization that has 14 offices in South Florida handling individual transactions. We have a very, very big organization of development sales that is exclusive sales of developments for other developers. Pretty much we work for all our competitors as the marketing and sales organization exclusively. We have today 24 different large projects that we manage and sell specifically for our development partners or competitors. And then we, about 5 years ago, created a company that does condominium financing or financing for those buyers that are acquiring projects, I mean, properties in our projects or in projects that we represent. Why? Because we saw a need in the market, especially for foreigners, that didn't want to provide all the information or couldn't provide all the information that typical and conventions were asking. And so we knew the asset, we knew the customer, and have capital to deploy it in that. And so we provide those, the financing for those buyers that are purchase a unit and were given the bus and now have to close and get a finance. So it's been great and makes their life and decision easier. So, and of course, we have a very robust property management because those people that typically buy for investments don't want to deal with the day-to-day of the tenant has a refrigerator that doesn't work. So we really do a great job at servicing that, and that's we keep them loyal to us because
that's great. First of all, to be able to get information on your competitors' projects when your brokers are involved.
Well, I think that it's a two-way street. I mean, yes, we do get, of course, a lot of information on our competitor projects, but I always, when we have this conversation, why would I give you my building that that you're my competitor somewhere else? And I said, who would you rather have sitting next to you when you're designing? Me, or that understands and sits on, puts your developer hat too, and doesn't do everything that the broker wants to do. I mean, larger units, cheaper price, and more expensive. So, or me saying, no, we need to do this, and this is more rational. So I've been able to convince pretty much all of my competitors, partners, that we are the right person to handle their projects.
I want to make one more little mention, actually a plug for one of our academic programs. The gentleman who was the head of that financing arm started out as an intern at Vester, and he's in our accelerated MBA in real estate program, from being an intern for 6 months all the way up to heading the company. And it was really wonderful to have companies like Fortune International that support our students.
Yeah, Zach Simpkins is a superstar. I really, I always thank you for sending me. And we have several of your people intern for us, and Malak is another one of them that she was started helping in acquisitions, and then she was more aggressive than my head of acquisitions, calling people left and right to try to buy their properties or terminate the condominium. So it's really a great partnership. I mean, like you said, Zach started for 6 months and he kept growing through. Actually, the person that started the financing company as a CEO was a person that now works in McKinsey for Andre. And he left McKinsey and left Zach in charge of it. And Zach, for the last 2 years, has an incredible job in growing the company.
So, So can we talk a little bit actually about leadership? I think, Edgardo, you've built probably one of the really enduring real estate players in South Florida. How would you describe your philosophy on leadership?
Well, I mean, I'm a firm believer that that you have to have fun and chemistry in the place that you work, and you need to be happy where you work. But, of course, the leader is the person that is willing to follow because they really have a passion and a specific plan that people can fall behind and follow him. But you have to they also have the ability to communicate and to teach. I mean, my leadership style is no micromanagement. It's a lot of micro. I'm a lot more of a listener than a talker. I mean, they always kind of joke in my company that when we have a big meeting, I don't say anything until the end, and I say two words, and that's what people do. But it's not because it's my way. It's because I listen to all the opinions and really value the opinions, and then decide on what the best course of action is. So it's really important to empower people to do what they do best. We in our organization look for people that, first of all, they have chemistry with the existing organization. I never hire one person on my own, especially in the upper level. They go to 3 or 4 interviews with different people a lot more about not only their abilities or the capacities, but if we all feel that there's a great fit, because it's, we call it the Fortune family, and it really is a Fortune family. I mean, many of us travel together, many of us vacation together, and Fridays we have lunch together. So it's really we were talking about people working from home and stuff. People want to come on Fridays to the office because we have lunch together and they share their experience and stuff. So it's a very important part of our culture and our organization to feel good at home. And it's not a pressure type of organization, but an organization that empowers people to do well. I mean, I'm tough in the sense that I don't allow you to not do and not to perform, but it's not screaming or not being outspoken, but more about making sure that you do what you're supposed to do.
I guess I have a follow-on question related to leadership. Do you think the nature of leadership is changing because of other changes going on? So I think younger people in the workforce maybe have different expectations. The economy is changing in interesting ways. The way in which we do work and where we do work is changing. So do you think that leadership itself is changing, and do you see your own leadership changing as a response to that?
Yes, I think that obviously that you need to adapt. And it's really the mountain of information that you have at your fingertips now with your phone and the ability to work from anywhere in the world and to communicate in different ways has changed significantly. So you do need to adapt. But there's a lot to say about cooperation, interaction. I mean, when I'm trying to establish if the person is a good fit, one of my key components is generosity, but not generosity of the people that giving out, but being able to share your knowledge and not take really ownership of anything, but be something that is a product of the work of the team. We're really very focused on both rewarding great work, but also being able to share your qualities with other people so they can be exponentially improved.
We've heard a good bit about leadership. I have a feeling that your skills may be needed in the next 6 months or so. What are your thoughts about both the near term and the longer term future of real estate in South Florida, specifically given that the Fed continued to raise interest rates for a while?
We have been always very disciplined on what we do. My philosophy is I'd rather make a mistake by not doing something that probably I should have done than by doing something that I should have. So we're not a production company that does 20 buildings at the time. We like to do 3 or 4 buildings of a very high end, very high caliber, and pay a lot of attention to detail. And really, as I was saying before, understanding what the customer wants and needs. I mean, and not only our job is not only to understand what they want today, but since projects are take 3 or 4 or 5 years, what they are going to want in the future, and really that's the bigger challenge. So we're always trying to figure out how people are going to live and how we can influence the way people live and provide a better quality of lifestyle. Today's buyer is not only buying a unit in the building, but it's more lifestyle, and it's really, really important to create the experience, to create the moments in the different places in order for them to enjoy. I have a lot more pleasure when a buyer of mine comes to me and said, "I love living in your building," than when one comes and says, "Oh, I made a lot of money. I bought it at this and I sold it at that." I mean, of course, that's great. I'm very pleased with that. But in general terms, it gives me a lot more pleasure to see people, especially when they come from Latin America or something like that, that they couldn't even go out in their own backyard and come here and they have so much fun and enjoy the places that we build.
And you're still bullish on South Florida's
market? I'm extremely. I mean, we talking about it. I'm really very, very positive. And this is, obviously I'm biased, but it's the best place to live in the world. And when we go to places where we travel all the time, I'm already in Miami, and you sense it on the people. Everybody wants a piece of Miami.
So you mentioned a couple of minutes ago that, you know, Fortune International is really like a family. but maybe that's in maybe more ways than one.
Yes.
So that, you know, you actually have a number of family members involved in the business. Can you tell us a little bit about how different members of the family are involved? And also, I guess at some point, not to push you into premature retirement.
I'm ready.
there'll be some.
When I read that George Perez is in Tahiti today and Venice tomorrow and stuff, I said I want to be him.
So can you say a little bit then about this other aspect of family business, because that is an additional dimension which actually is quite common in South Florida. There are a lot of very successful businesses which are also undergoing a generational transition. So you could hear your thoughts.
Yes,
on that.
I mean, obviously the most important and part of my family and to some extent my business is my wife. I mean, we've been working together for 20, I mean, actually today is our 27th anniversary.
Oh,
so, I mean,
congratulations.
But really, I mean, she's amazing, but she's not only an inspiration, but motivation. I mean, people really follow her, and she grew in the business on the sales side. So she really, really took the time to understand what the customer wants, and now really heading basically the development team on the design aspects of it, because more than the specific design on the programming and type of features that the project should have. And really, we have an incredible relationship that, because we have mutual respect for each other, as long as I say yes when but it's really been a fun ride, and it's sort of translated or expelled to our children. And we have three boys, 19, 17, and 15, and they're from when they were very little, we kept taking them to the job sites, and even during the pandemic, Andres, my oldest, started to listen to my Zoom meetings and sat next to me, and he was so into it that after school started, he came after school and started coming to the office, and really, really taking the call for real estate in a very big way. And the other two are the same, and to some extent they're very, very different. I mean, very analytical, very conscientious about expenses and all that, other than when he goes out with his friends at the university. On Saturdays, he's not as much cost-conscious, but I wish him to be. But,
it's from a different budget.
Exactly. But when he's at the office, even after the meeting's finished and the next day in the morning, he's at class and he calls and says, I think we should do this instead of that. And I said, okay, thank you, Andres. But he's really, I run into his physical trainer the other day, and I said, oh, you're doing a great job. He loves to, and he said, oh, no, you're doing a great job. Because when we're training and we talk about business, his face changes. I mean, he's really, really into what you're doing, and he loves it. So I'm very, very happy with that. The other two are at Ransom, and one in 11th, and the other in 10th, and they also are very interested in business, and they're very different. One is very organized, very methodical. The middle one is really full of ideas that, of course, 100 of them are not worth, but one really is going to. But he's every time. I mean, we try to make a point of having dinner together all the time, and every dinner he has something new, you know, very creative sense, and sometimes they make a lot of sense. And the third one is the social guy in the family. I mean, he has friends constantly in the home and stuff, and I always tease him that that happens to be the closest friends are the one that is invite him in to go in the private and to Hamptons, or invited him to go to two weeks in the Mediterranean and 300 per yacht. So he's the one that's going to do the fundraising in the but he and also probably spend all the money that you guys made. So they were trying to form in without really pushing them to, because I'm a firm believer that you have to have a passion. If not, you better do something else. But I believe that they all like it, and I have a team under me that is very, very capable, and you know, Eduardo and some of them, and my brother-in-law and Cristina's brother, who's 43, is also very, very capable and handling many of the aspects of the organization. So I have if I wanted to let go, I have a team that could really lead the company and mentor them into. But they know that they have to earn it. I mean, they're not going to, because the last name is DeFortuna, they're not going to be in charge of the company if they're not capable of doing that. And I think that sometimes that's the mistake of family companies that put their children ahead of people that are potentially more capable than that. I mean, they little by little, I mean, Andres is now coming twice or three times a week to the office and really taking the time to learn and to listen to everything with him. So it's really a pleasure. I mean, when he says, I'm only going to apply to this person, I'm not going anywhere. He had great grades and great ACT and stuff like that. Pretty much anywhere he decided to be here, it was very pleasant for me. I mean, I was very, very happy.
We are. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
We have covered a lot of different topics tonight. I think probably we talk if there's any questions from the audience. I think there are a couple microphones back here. Anybody have a question you want to ask? I think no topic is off limits. I think. Yeah, there's actually one here and one in there. Let's take one with the microphone.
Hello. Yeah. Okay, well, thank you for coming. My name is Jaja Goldstrom. So I wanted to ask, how has your recent partnership with Christie's International impacted Fortune International? And have you noticed a reaction from your clients?
Well, thank you. I mean, I forgot to mention that. And it's really a very important move that we made. And the clientele, the pandemic shift, from people from Latin America to very significantly US-based clients and some European clients. So I wanted to give a tool to my team to be able to get referrals and to cooperate with other offices. Even though we had an individual relationship, we didn't have a structured relationship for referrals and for being able to service clients from different parts of the country and the world. So when I studied the landscape, I decided that Christie's was really the perfect fit for us because, of course, with our Basel and the connection with the art world and Christie's being the best auction house and the art world, it really brought together the type of client that we try to target, especially at the very high-end projects that we develop. And when you do companies in the brokerage business are getting a lot more sophisticated in technology and in ways to approach the customer and the customer acquisition. And I think that Christie's has an excellent platform when it comes to that and making it easier for the agent to really create marketing materials and expose themselves to the community in order to be able to and expose the properties that they represent. So it's really, obviously, it's kind of early in the game. We started in September, October, but I already see a change in the perception. And even the developers that we represent love the fact that, that we now have a, an expanded network of people that, that really are exposed to our product and project. So it's been a very strategic move that I think is going to pan out very, very well for us. And type of referrals that we're getting already are very significant. When we sold a $55 million penthouse in December from to Christie's, it's very, very good.
I would love to see that penthouse.
Yeah, yeah. It's not yet. I mean, we sell the dream before it's
exactly.
It's not built yet.
Hi, good morning. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Similar pricing question and kind of question on how you think about the market today versus what you were speaking about the culture of Miami and the folks who want to live in your buildings, stay here long term to build what became a culture that brought Art Basel and kind of what makes Miami Miami. Tibor Hallo said, in Brickell that people are lining out the door for his buildings and he's going to raise rents 100%. And there's somebody else when they go, if they complain about it, that's their problem. So
yeah, and I'm managing the 821 unit building that he has. So I hear your pain.
Brickell, Sunny Isle, South Beach, rents raising, over 100% in those areas, bringing up average rents to 30-40% overall in the city.
Yeah.
How do you think about short-term pricing or how do you think about pricing today reflective of the culture you want to build in your buildings and the folks you want to bring, cognizant of VC dollars living here and finance from New York and everywhere around the world wanting to be here, Latin American, immigration from different countries having the opportunity to buy and rent in Miami.
Yeah, I think that if we have an issue, or one significant issue in Miami, it's affordability for the mid-tier employees and the scarcity of that type of product is really a big concern because it's hard to attract great talent, especially from other places if they can't afford the rent. And even if they're here already and they have to move an hour away because they can't pay the use your example, the Tibor Hallo rents. I mean, it's really a challenge and something that we're very, very concerned about. And it has to be a public-private type of effort to try to resolve the affordability crisis as far as the housing crisis that we potentially might be facing. So that, and we're very concerned about that and trying to figure out ways to do that. And also, we have a big division in our company that does that's trying to do environmentally friendly buildings that leave a less of a footprint on the environment. So it really we are very conscious about that. And we're trying to apply a lot of the concept of environmentally sound buildings. It's hard because the buyer, especially the foreign buyer, not necessarily want to, they would like it, but they don't like to pay for the additional cost. But I think that it needs to be a trend that it's already in the office market, it's already well implemented, but we need to continue to do that and bigger efforts on the residential side. But fortunately, Miami is constrained by water on one side and the Everglades on the other. So the lack of availability for land and the influx of outsiders, quote unquote, that come and because of the need raise their prices, makes the people that live here have suffered the affordability of some of those properties. And obviously, they need to be, as I said, maybe areas where they have more density in order to be able to. Able to afford the land and build more affordable type units for people to be able to work closer to their places. But there's less mobility today, and people concentrating more in areas where they live, and offices being popped up in places, so they don't have to come all the way to Brickell or downtown.
Well, we're just seeing who has the next question. I want to do one quick follow-up there. We haven't really talked about sustainability, which you mentioned, and it's if you sort of say which geographies in the U.S. might be subject to, you know, the impacts of climate change, rising sea level, you already see a bunch of big issues. You know, residential insurance has gotten a lot more expensive. A number of people have left the market. You see banks now looking at what is the climate risk in their lending portfolios and so on. How do you see that playing out for your business and for real estate in South Florida in general? And you know, what do you think the industry needs to be doing to tackle these issues?
I mean, obviously, it's not a simple answer, and we are very concerned about the, you just mentioned, the rising sea levels and the insurance costs are really to the roof, and when those insurance costs or insurance companies disappear, it's going to create a very difficult situation in the market, because if you can't insure it, the bank is not going to finance it, and it's a chain effect. So we're working with some of the city leaders to try to really create a platform to be able to positively tackle that and really share the information that other cities and places in order to be able to have Miami. And to some extent, the problem with Miami is, to some extent, that it's atomizing very many municipalities, and each of the municipalities and not only have their own tax base and they use it for their own needs, but rather than the potential need of the entire community. So trying to combine their efforts in solving the problem that is all of us is really a challenge.
Yes, I can't wait to find the solution.
Yeah, no, I mean, actually, we have a big crowd here that really try to figure out something.
Other questions?
Awesome. Yeah, thank you. So thank you for taking the time. Good morning. My name is Nabil. So we've heard a lot about Fortune in the now. I would like to open up the door and see what kind of your vision, maybe 10-year plan is for Fortune. How do you see the growth within your company? And then have you considered the possibility of going the more public route with Fortune?
Future banker.
Yes, I guess so. But I don't see ourselves as going public. I mean, maybe we're in the technology aspects of it. We're developing a platform to invest in real estate based on blockchain and stuff that hopefully will grow, and maybe some parts of the organization could be eventually public. But I see this as really, we like to really do the things that we know how to do. And expanding for me would be to do more of a diversified type of product. I mean, we've been looking at doing multifamily rather than all condo sale, in order to some extent satisfy the need of affordability and make a product that is more accessible to everybody, and really concentrate on other areas in Florida that less of a supply and but that we can bring quote unquote our DNA of creating great lifestyles and have a competitive edge versus other developers, continue to really solidify our marketing web into the markets that really are attracted to South Florida. If you ask me what distinguishes our company from the rest of the development companies in Miami, is the marketing ability that we have to sell the product within, and that when the financial crisis of 2007-2009 came, we were the company pretty much all the banks wanted to do business with, even though we had our own issues and our own good things, but the banks obviously knew a lot less than we did about real estate. And so they came and they gave us the buildings to finish if they need to finish that, to market it, and to try to figure out how to dispose of all those assets, because we really have the machinery to be able to sell. Obviously, they had to be adjusting prices and different ways of creating incentives for people to buy again. But really specializing on what we do is what I want to focus more on the next 10 years.
Hi again.
Hi. Another smart question.
So TV Home announced that there has been a 68% increase in cancellations of new homes for quarter four. Have you noticed an increase in cancellations for the real estate commercial market because of what's going on, or not necessarily in South Florida?
It's a great question again. There are two types of purchases, one of existing homes or existing condominiums, and what we do more, which is pre-construction sales with all with ours and other developers. And because of the interest rates and because of the perception of recession, the existing homes have a decline in volume of sales, and also people are potentially canceling because of higher interest rates and that they can't afford what they thought that they could buy. So if you're talking about existing homes, it's lower. But the other side of the coin is that for pre-construction buildings, we're using the inflation as a way to sell, in the sense that you're buying a unit today that is going to be delivered 4 years from now. So you fix the price. So it's a great protection against inflation. You don't have to get a mortgage until you take possession. 4 years from now, the perception, at least today, is that mortgage rates are eventually going to decline. So when 3 or 4 years from now, it'll be lower than now. So we've seen an increase in pre-construction sales rather than a decrease, which is remarkable in some sense.
Good morning. Again, thank you for being here. I think it's stellar to have the kids be able to have some exposure to somebody like you. It's great to have your support with the school. I'm alumni. I'm trying to create a business down here. I launched an extraordinarily successful business in New York, and it created the traffic in South Florida. So we're down here. Been successful with clients, the Ytex, the Meneses, and the Lucis, and whomever's. Mm-hmm. They're building, property for those projects. And love to hear your thoughts on, the impact of, a magnet like Ken Griffin relocating, being behind the market, which in our opinion is a really positive thing, regardless of potential direction, because he's going to bring so many employees here, and not all of them are going to be there. Those people are going to need apartments, like best relevant for you because you build top tier condos, but which I'm sure there'll be for you guys that'll buy those condos. But kind of seeing this creation of West Brickell, on the other side of above grade Metro Rail, and the apartments that are needed. I guess my question is, what impact do you think Citadel and all the ancillary vendors and consultants and service providers are going to have on the multifamily market?
I think it's huge. They really are going to transform Brickell, and West Brickell has already been transformed before the boom of Brickell downtown. one block west of regular Miami Avenue. It's kind of the suburbs. Now it's all the way to 95. Really, obviously, a lot of that transformation, city center created a great force there to get movement around it, and it was a spectacular development. But I think that it's a great area. I mean, imagine, I mean, I have an office there for 20 years, and before we had to order lunch and eat at the office. It wasn't a place to work, I mean, to walk anywhere. And now we can go to the restaurant every day of the week for a month and not repeat one. And so it's really the vibrancy of that and the values. And, when we did Jay Bricko Residence, Story Tower in 2000, and I bought the land in 1999 for 19 million, 2.5 acres on the water there, and Tibor Holo had just bought 6 months ago the land next door for 17, the same 2.5 acres, one next to the other. I argue that mine is better because it has better south, better than north. But I mean, it was basically, and the Miami Herald wrote an article that I overpaid for it. We did Jay Brickle, great success. We actually sold units sometimes 3 times before they were delivered because the prices were kept going up. And I felt like the smartest guy in the world, and we did a wonderful building success. Move forward 20 years later, didn't do anything. He built, they were, I met 20 times them designing new buildings and doing things, and he never put a shovel on the ground, never started sell. Yeah. 20 years later, he sells the land for $360 million. So, yeah. That gives you a little bit of, I mean, to Ken Griffin, actually. So that gives you a little bit of a perspective of what's happening on Brickell. I mean, it's really an incredible transformation of a beautiful place to live and work.
So we hear about West Brickell. I wonder what they're going to call the neighborhood west of I-95. We need a glamorous name for that. Things are starting. I think we have one more question if we have time.
Yeah, I was just wondering, how are you dealing with the increased construction costs? It seems like it's kind of a double-edged sword with the pre-construction sales going well, but construction costs, the acceleration of those lagging.
Yes, it's a huge issue, we all love to pre-sell the buildings significantly, 60 or 70%, which is a great thing because obviously you can use the deposits of those buyers to use it as equity and to cover part of the cost of construction. But the cost of construction are and were sort of out of control for a while. And we seem to be tapering up in many ways. The issue is twofold. I mean, supply of some of the materials and cost of those materials, and also margins from the subs because they feel that they have a great pipeline of business and they were not willing to take any price cuts. And today, we feel that's softening, that some of the ones that were on the pipeline are no longer in the pipeline. And the subcontractors are really realizing that they better adjust their prices. Not going to be able to do it. But to answer your question, there are some projects that, not that we're developing, that we're involved that pre-sold quickly and at quote unquote low prices, even though they seem high at the time. And now they're trying to make ends meet to be able to build that at the cost of construction today. Locally, in many ways, the price appreciation sales was as big, if not more, than the increasing cost of construction. So most of the buildings are still okay, but it's a big challenge being able to maintain cost and not cut corners enough to be able to deliver the product.
So maybe, thanks for all those questions. Maybe one last question for you, which is, you mentioned that George Perez is in Tahiti and Venice.
Yes.
When you're in Tahiti and Venice and you're sitting reflecting on your legacy, What would you like to say your legacy has been?
I like, as I said before, to improve the quality of life of people. I think that that's something that really we have passion for, and try to really understand what makes people happy, and when they're living in a place is a key component to our philosophy. And so I would like to hopefully be perceived as a good leader that was fair, that would really care about the product that we need sold or delivered to our customers.
Great. With that, I think on behalf of everyone here, thank you for taking the time this morning.
I hope that I'm glad that we have video, because the crowd is bigger than the one that George was. Because he's very competitive. I have more people than.
It doesn't count if Andres is paying everyone $20.
You are. Well, next time, you have to tell them what your experience is as a student in our company.
Great. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks,
everybody.
Perfect.
Thanks.